Friends, I have great pleasure in introducing Dr. A.C. Machi Garu, who is going to deliver a lecture on mechanization in coconut today. And Dr. A.C. Machi Garu is working as principal scientist at CPCRA, Kasaragod, and has a vast experience of more than 30 years. And see, to his credit, he has developed prototypes for more than 25 machineries or gadgets, of which 3 have been already patented, and is the recipient of 1 international and 2 national awards. And he has received the Water Environment Federation of McGee Groundwater Protection, Restoration and Sustainable Use International Award during 2015, and was awarded the Best Research Worker of the Year by Coconut Development Board India during 2012. And he was also a member of the team which has received the Best ICR Award for Outstanding Team Research for the biennium 2003-04 on the project development of technologies for on-farm engineering and post-harvest processing of coconut. Friends, I hope, I'm very sure his vast experience would enlighten all of us on the mechanization in coconut in particular and all other plantation crops in general. And now I request Dr. A.C. Machi Garu to address all our participants, and over to Dr. Mathew Garu. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Friends, sir, good evening to all. Today we will be discussing more about post-harvest machineries of coconut and a little bit of on-farm mechanization. Why the talk on-farm mechanization? Mainly mechanization happened in the area of irrigation and land preparation and other cultural activities, which it is another same duration of time. Coming to on-farm mechanization, the latest development is that air blast sprayers for coconut, the institute has developed recently. That immediate provocation for development of these sprayers was that recent whitefly infestation in coconut. Our institute recommends neem oil spray or even ordinary water, fresh water spray from the bottom that will disturb the colonies of whitefly. However, reaching a height of say 25 meter tall palm, that was a challenge. And there are sprayers available in the market, but majority of them goes say around 10 meter or so. It's good for small palms and even up to medium height. Beyond that, we need these sprayers. Two sprayers we developed there. One is Primover for one first sprayer. That means that tractor-driven sprayer, what you are seeing in that first figure. With a powerful blower, we will blow the air, and an atomizer is provided at the tip of that sprayer, with which it atomizes, and that spray in the atomized form, it reaches to the coconut canopy. You can see the design of these bent design of these dams. There are two couplings here. One is here. You can see one small motor, and bottom also one coupling is there. With the help of these couplings, in a vertical axis, it can rotate. What I mean to say is that the lands can be tilted from horizontal position to vertical position, and it can be rotated at 360 degrees. What I mean is that entire canopy it can cover. The spray can reach up to a height of 30 meters. The second one is that a miniature form of the first sprayer, where a Honda engine, you can see, air blast sprayer is attached. Here also that spray can be directed with using this horizontal lever provided. Either it can be carried by a 2 persons, or it could be attached to a tractor. the both the sprayers can cover an area of 1 hectare per 3 hours. That means the normal speed of any practice. Other specifications are given here. Coconut harvesting is still the single most important problem facing by all coconut farmers. Small coconut farms, it can be harvested using a bamboo pole or even aluminium lightweight pole or something like that. However, tall palms, still majority of the palms are harvested by climbing the tree. It is not only for climbing, not only for harvesting. However, nowadays that NIRA, that tapping, that needs climbing the tree twice a day. You can see that different types of climbing adopted by persons. That left top, what you are seeing, that Kerala, majority of the coconut climbers climb like this. However, that it's a very tedious job, and traditional climbers are becoming very rare. And several organizations and even individuals try to develop a coconut climbing device. Here in the top left, you can see that TNA device. Here, two parts are there. One is a bottom part and the upper part. The upper part, a seat is provided on which a person can comfortably sit. And you can see that by sitting the top part, he can lift, he has to lift the bottom portion with his legs. And after lifting it, you will stand on this bottom portion and lift this top portion by his hands. And every time sitting and lifting, it's not an easy job. It's a very tedious job, and a person can climb some 3 or 4 palms, not more than that, if that palms are tall. And left bottom, you can see, this is developed by a farmer way back in 1980s. His name is Mr. Joseph. Previous year he expired. Even now, this is the only commercially used coconut climbing device anywhere in the world. So you can see that how a person is climbing using this climbing device. It's a paddle type climbing device. When he lifts the leg, this machine gets loosened and he will rise it with hand. The moment he apply his body weight over here, it will be stuck to that coconut palm. A person can easily climb 100 coconuts per day. Though that machine developed by that farmer was pretty good, however, the only lacuna we faced is that doesn't have a safety mechanism attached to it. In case of accidental fall or that machine failure, the climber will be falling from such a tall palm. It will be fatal. So CPCRA has developed a safety mechanism which is independent of the climbing device. In case of accidental fall or machine failure, you can see that he will be comfortably hanging from the tree. His life is saved. And the same safety mechanism can be used in the case of traditional climbing also. CPCRA also did its effort to make a climbing device. These are climbing devices developed by CPCRA. It's just a U-frame. Attached to that frame, one shoes is provided. That person can wear the shoes and climb up and down, just like ladder. However, lifting, though this frame weighs only, together it will weigh only 1.25 kg, lifting it with the legs at one end. We engineers, we call it the eccentric load. It's not that easy. A safety mechanism is provided here also. Coming to partial arrest operations, de-husking is the first operation in any partial arrest operations of coconut. This is a simple coconut de-husking machine utilized by almost all the households. It's developed by our Kerala Agricultural University. It's called a Keramitra. This is good for household purpose, but for industrial purpose, it's not sufficient. That's why CPCRA has developed one coconut de-husking machine where a person needs to just feed the coconut. That coconut, after getting de-husked, it will come out from here. Provision is made in this machine to keep that small portion of husk at the eye portion to enhance the shelf life. If you are utilizing that coconut immediately after de-husking, that also will be removed and fall from here. The capacity is 150 coconuts per hour. Among the post-harvest products, among the coconut products, still copra plays the major role. And this is the one small dryer we developed for small farmers. It is having a capacity of 400 nuts per batch. It takes 36 hours. What we do is that any agricultural fuel or agricultural waste, you can fire it here. There is a tray here, and here there is a drum. When you fire this husk or any agricultural waste, that outer drum gets heated up, and that hot air will come into contact with copra, which is kept in this portion. Here there is a wire mesh, and over that coconut are kept after cutting open, and the smoke will go through this pipe. Only that hot air will come into contact with copra. That's why the copra will be of very good quality, white color. The problem with that previous dryer was a person needs to keep the fuel every half an hour. With the present labor cost, that's a costly affair. That's why we developed another copra dryer, which is having a capacity of 1500. A miniature form of this with the 500 capacity also we developed. Here only coconut shell can be used as fuel. Here, two furnaces are provided where a tray is provided in a U shape and coconut shell, one inside the other, we kept it in a U form and fire at one end. And it gets a fire, the fire will be slowly proceeding, and it takes keep 4 to 6 hours of heat inside. That means a person need not attend all the time. That's the advantage of this dryer. Other details I have given here. And the solar dryer, it's a very common thing among all the crops, including chili and all. Here, one copra dryer also we developed. However, this solar dryer will work pretty good in areas where atmospheric humidity is less. The places like coastal area of Kerala or even Andhra Pradesh or anywhere, that when the humidity is high, and in case that sunlight is not strong enough, that moisture escaped from the copra will get condensed inside the chamber. You may even watch drops of water falling down. This leads to fungal attack and the quality of copra will be reduced. To overcome this situation, what Siptare did is that we provided another a heater along with that solar dryer. Whenever the temperature goes down beyond a limit, that heater will automatically switch on and heat the inside area, thereby avoiding that condensation. Since that electrical energy is a costly affair, we provided a third source of fuel also. That is, any agricultural waste also you can fire. That hot air will heat the solar dryer whenever required. That means whenever that cloudy time or during night time also you can dry it. After drying to a certain extent, a coconut shell needs to be removed from the kernel. That is called coconut deshelling. Traditionally, what they do is that with the help of a small bamboo knife, they insert the knife in between the kernel and the coconut shell and scoop it out. It's a tedious process. Tedious means not tedious alone. It's a cumbersome process and time consuming. That's what CPCRA has developed, one coconut deshelling machine. Here you can see this motor, this drum get rotated. Inside the drum, there are three fins inside. This copra, while rotating, this copra will be loaded and it will be closed, and it will be, this drum will be rotating, and while rotating, that copra from the bottom will be taken to the top with the fin, and after reaching a certain height, it will fall down. Because of that impact, it shall get detached. Another machine is the copra moisture meter. It's an analog meter. Usually, copra needs to be dried. That final moisture content should be around 4 to 6%. If it is not dried properly, that keeping quality of copra will not be good, and also the coconut oil extracted from that copra, the rancidity comes very fast. Generally, the merchants, when they purchase copra from farmers, they feel it in their hands. Of course, that experienced person can detect somewhat of in a good manner, but it may not be correct always. That's why this machine is used. You can, two needles are there. With that needles, you can pierce inside the kernel and you can read that. It should be between that green portion for a good quality copra. You can see that tender nut is becoming a very good drink in anywhere in the streets, all over India, you can see that. Generally, what they do is that they cut open by their bare hands, hands and with a knife, and it's slightly time consuming. And actually, we don't need to partially dehusk that tender nut before drinking. What we need here is with this machine, we will make a hole and a straw can be inserted and drink it. And after drinking, it can be cut open and take that kernel inside if he wishes. The tricky portion here while designing this punch is, whenever you pierce it, no portion of that husk should come into contact with the water inside. even if a small portion comes into contact with that water, that entire taste will change. That's why while piercing, that coconut husk, the coconut husk will be kept, kept inside this hollow portion. After removing that coconut with the hair, it can be this will go also, this will be pushed down to take the cut portion outside. What I mean to say is that no physical contact of that husk will be coming in with the tender water inside. Another product of tender nut is that snowball tender nut. That nomenclature is mainly because of the white color. Here what we do is that tender nut is usually harvested say 6 to 7 months old. For a snowball tender nut, we will harvest slightly mature one, that means 7 to 8 months old. And we make a groove at the center portion using this machine. And using a nylon knife, we insert this nylon knife in between this kernel and shell and scoop it out and serve it an ice cream cup. A person who consume, we can consume the water piercing simply by piercing that tender nut using a straw, and after drinking it, you can consume it also. There won't be any waste. Now you may be, you could understand that why we are harvesting at 7 to 8 months. This kernel or tender nut should be stable enough to withstand in a ice cream cup, and at the same time it should be tender enough for consumption. Generally this is served in five-star hotels as a welcome drink, or even tourist places, even in hospitals. But many of the hospitals, they prefer that tender nut water, but they don't allow tender nut to be taken inside. And for such purposes also, this will be of useful. Another one is the tender nut coconut trimming machine. Here what we do is that partially de-husk that coconut, tender coconut, and the top and with the help of this machine, and top and bottom will be cut, and this way we can reduce the size of the tender coconut, and that shape also will be very good. Coming to other machineries utilized for say coconut chips, desiccated coconut, virgin coconut oil, all these things, what we do is that the kernel we will be taking out from the shell and do further processing. The kernel is removed from the fresh coconut generally by using such type of a knife, but it's a time consuming process, and most of the time that kernel gets broken, and when it is broken, further that testa, that removal of that red portion will be of difficult. And when doing with that manually done, it is capacity is 20 to 25 nuts per hour, depending on the experience of that person who handles it. Sipichari has developed a coconut shell removing machine. You can see here, with the help of this machine, anybody can remove that shell from the inside kernel. That kernel will come out in a just like a ball copra, the whole four. The capacity is 120 to 150 nuts, and chance of breakage is only 2%. And here you can see that after the removal of coconut shell, the testa, that brown portion, needs to be removed. Generally, it is removed using a potato peeler by hand. Again, that takes time, only 30 nuts per hour a person can remove the testa. Here also the one motor has been developed. Here you can see this drum rotates, the surface of the drum it is abrasive. If that operator can just press slightly that coconut towards this one, and the coconut testa, you can see here, it comes out as a powder form. The previous case, slight kernel also will be lost along with that testa. Here only testa will be removed, and much faster. It has a capacity of 200 coconuts per hour. This is a simple coconut grating machine. After removing the testa, this needs to be powdered before extracting milk or go for DC, drying. It's a very fast machine. After removing the testa and powdering it, now it's we need to take the milk out. A series of milk extractors we developed for different purposes. This can be even a household or even a very marginal, very small factories can use it. This is slightly bigger. Here, what we do is that we keep that coconut gratings inside and press it with the help of this lever. And there is a limit for pressing, human pressing with this lever. Thereby, we kept one hydraulic jack at the bottom, just like our when our car or something puncture, we use that hydraulic jack to lift the car. Same way, one hydraulic jack is provided. Then after pressing this one, that hydraulic jack will be operated, and up to 8 tons of pressure you can apply. That milk will come out, and it will be collected at the bottom. And this is a hydropneumatic milk extractor. Both are similar machines, only the capacity varies. Here, everything is done automatically. Here, the coconut gratings will be kept, and all the operations, you can set it in this PLC, programmable logical controller. That pressure, up to what pressure we need to apply, how much duration you need to apply, everything. And that milk will be coming here, and that residue will be pushed from this side. Though that hydropneumatic is a completely automated machine, that maximum efficiency of any extracting machines, you get it from a screw type expellers. That's why we developed the 3 screw type expellers. This is a single screw, which is having a capacity of 300 coconuts per hour. And this is also a single screw with a mechanism to cool the product while expelling. You know that anything, when you apply pressure, it generates heat. And in oil expellers and all, we can see that temperature goes beyond even 100 degrees centigrade. Here also, it gets heated up while pressing. Here, 2 knobs you can see. Through this one, we circulate that water at the around the screw. That's why milk will be extracted at room temperature. And this is the latest machine, which is a double screw expeller, which has got a capacity of 1,000 coconuts per hour. It's good for any big industries, small or big. That machine can handle any amount of coconut gratings. Coming to one product, that virgin coconut oil. This is extracted from fresh and mature coconut by mechanical means. It's the purest form of oil you can expect. It contains vitamin E, antioxidant, polyphenols, and the benefits of all these things you must be knowing. And to use just functional, cosmetic, or even pharmaceutical oil. And CPCRI has standardized the processing technology and all the machinery required for the production by either hot process or fermentation process. And VCO can be prepared in four different methods. One is direct expelling. What we do is that coconut gratings, we dry it and expel in any type of expeller. For that, this dryer is utilized. This is a food grade stainless steel. Fire will be put inside and gratings will be kept here. And it will be slowly, manually, moved from one side to another. By the time it reaches the other end, it will be dried. Another method is hot processing, where that milk will be heated up and virgin coconut oil will be prepared. It's a traditional way of preparing virgin coconut oil. The traditional method, what we do is that we keep it in an open container and fire it at the bottom. There the problem is that it needs continuous stirring, and that since that fire is coming directly into contact with the milk in the container, chances of getting it charred is very high in that. Thereby, we developed, CPCRI has developed one virgin coconut oil cooker. It's a double jacketed vessel. Inside the jacket, we filled it with thermic fluid. Thermic fluid is a very good heat transfer media utilized in all the industries. Thereby, that heat is not, flame is not coming directly into contact with the milk inside. The temperature we can accurately control. And it is provided with an automatic stirrer also. It continuously stirs that milk inside. That means once you pour that milk inside, you need not attend it. It will be done, everything will be done mechanically. And this cooker is made of biogas. Since for convenience, we use LPG. It could be easily connected with biogas also. All the safety mechanism like pressure release valve, everything is provided here. After say around 4 to 6 hours, depending on the amount of milk provided inside, this lever will be opened and that oil will be collected at the bottom. This cooker is of 125 liters, but that is immaterial. A cooker of any dimension can be made. It's simply you can scale it up. And this is another cooker where you can fire any agricultural waste in this here one furnace is provided. Remaining all the things is similar to the earlier one. Even electrical cookers are available. Even steam also you can put it in between that jacketed portion. This is another method of making virgin coconut oil. This is a centrifuge. After making, after extracting oil, it is put it in that centrifuge and rotate it at high speed. As you know that specific gravity of oil is less than the specific gravity of water. So that centrifuge, that's the principle of working this centrifuge. Whatever so far I have shown, this is the only machine we procure from the market. All other machines are CPCRI, prototypes of CPCRI. And this is another method of VCO production. It is a fermentation method. What we do is that this coconut milk, we will be keeping in one drum, and after 18 to 22 hours, that oil gets separated. Some culture also we need to add, just like our household, how we prepare curd from cow milk. You can see that this is the oil portion and bottom that remaining unfermented milk. And a tank also is made for convenience. Here you can see that this is the oil portion. While removing that, it should not come into contact with that water below or that like the cream of the top. That's why it's made conical, and you can see that you can collect that oil without mixing it with the milk. Sorry, unfermented milk or that water. Another product of CPCR is the coconut chips. It is a coconut after removing the testa, slice it and dry it after osmotic dehydration. It's not a fried one. You can see that traditionally the chips was made using our potato slicer, commonly available in market. But again, the tedious and capacity is also slightly less. We have developed, CPCR has developed prototypes of two machines. This is the electrical machine where that coconut pieces can be fed here. There is a rotating drum inside with which that 1 millimeter thickness coconut slice will be falling from this side. A portion is made to slice even tuber crops like tapioca, even banana or any vegetable, even carrot or even bitter gourd, anything you can put it here and get the slice, get it sliced outside. And this is another manually operated slicing machine where it is connected to a sewing machine platform. That ladies who are familiar with that stitching, they can easily operate this machine. This is specifically made for some Kudumbasri units here. I mean, women self-help group, they were not having electricity. And these are this electrical dryers to dry that coconut chips after osmotic dehydration. This is also another dryer where any agricultural waste can be fired as fuel. This is the firing unit and furnace, which will be kept conveniently outside the building, and this portion will be kept inside the building. Only that hot air will be coming into contact with the chips inside. I mean, this is a recent development. Is Kalpirasa. Kalpirasa is, you know that toddy, all you people may be familiar, is an unfermented toddy. You can see it's very sweet. Traditionally, it is harvested by cutting that inflorescence, a small portion every day. Beyond that, certain process is there at the correct stage. That inflorescence will be tied and it will be by beating, we will be processing that inflorescence. Then that top portion we will be cutting. You can see that a portion that traditionally how it is made, and it is collected in earthen pots. The moment around 1 or 2 hours, within 1 or 2 hours, since it is rich in sugars and carbohydrates and all these things, it gets fermented very fast. That's why morning, even if we cut, by the time we go and collect it, it will be fermented. That fermented, that color you can see, it will be a whitish color. But actually, when it is immediately after cutting, when it is coming out, drop by drop, it will be golden yellow color. And the CPCR has developed there, you can see that color here. But CPCR has developed a coconut sub chiller where immediately after falling that coconut sap, it get cooled at the cold temperature. We keep it and we'll take it out and serve it in a cold chain. It's a very very rich in sugars, amino acids, minerals, antioxidants, many things are there in that kalpasa. This is the box coconut sap chiller we developed for the collecting. This is the Neera. We call it kalpasa. It's a trade name. And kalpasa can be served as such using this vending machine, because throughout that transportation, from collection to transportation and serving, it should be done in cold chain, otherwise it gets fermented. And a dispenser is required. If the dispenser, that you can serve it, or in case extra is available, or in case you want to make it into value-added products, you can prepare coconut sugar, jaggery, or even coconut honey and concentrate using this kalpasa. To make coconut sugar, you need to heat it. Usually, traditionally, it is done in the case of hot processed VCO in an open pan, continuous stirring. However, our VCO cooker can be utilized for making sugar also. We can keep the kalpasa inside this cooker and heat it up, and it will continuously stir till it is dried to the form of coconut sugar. Or in, after you can put put it in a mold. You can make coconut jaggery and coconut honey also if you take it slightly early. And coming to this commercialization part, all these processing machineries are kept in our agro processing center, and we do give technologies to the entrepreneurs who or startup firms who approach us. We collect some nominal fee also. When we collect nominal fee, that includes that hands-on training for the production. That means all these machineries involved in that. To a group of five people for 2 days, and we will be giving that machine drawing of all these machineries. What we wish is that at their end, let them fabricate it. Many times they are not comfortable manufacturing like that. There are three manufacturers who licensed it from our institute. Through them also, they can get it. And for further details, you can refer our website is given, cpcra.gov.in. And that's all for today's presentation. Any clarification, if you want, you can ask now. Anybody needs some clarification?
Students, do you have any doubts? You can ask. If you have any doubts, you can ask. Sir will clear your doubts. We'll send you feedback link. You can send them. Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot for your lecture covering the post-harvest aspects, different types of dryers, and also kalpasa. Thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you. Thank you all the teachers and students for patient hearing. Thank you, ma'am.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much, sir. కరెక్ట్ టైంకి కరెంట్ పోయింది చూసావు మనకి చాలా మంచిది.